Every major event in world history, every major figure in world history appears to be encoded in the Bible.
The Bible codes are a dramatic demonstration that what we have here really is the Word of God and not simply a historical tradition. These 66 books penned by 40 different guys over thousands of years are collectively a supernaturally given and skillfully engineered message system.
Ordinarily, we would assume that this building, the U.S. Pentagon, and anything having to do with the Bible would be far removed from one another. But in 1994, Statistical Science, a respected mathematics journal, published Report Number 3, Volume 9, titled Equidistant Letter Sequences in the Book of Genesis. That report found its way to this door.
Thank you, Harold.
This was the office of Harold Gann, senior cryptographer for the National Security Agency. But now he was absorbed in something else.
You still working on that Bible thing? Your little 386 at home has been crunching numbers for almost 2 weeks now.
19 days, actually. 14 hours and 21 minutes.
Gans knew that equidistant letter sequence was a code form widely used by various governments and their agents. The idea that they would occur in the book of Genesis was hard for him to believe.
I don't know why you're wasting your time. And this thing's either pure coincidence or pure nonsense.
I'm sure you're correct. But Rips designed the original program and Statistical Science published the findings.
Eliyahu Rips?
Mm-hmm.
He's a world-class mathematician. What's he doing messing with this religious stuff?
Makes you wonder, doesn't it?
He found it so difficult to believe that he wrote his own computer program based on his intimate knowledge of encryption techniques with the intent of disproving the results published by Statistical Science.
So here we are, the agency that cracked the Enigma code, the Japanese Purple code. We've got parallel link Cray supercomputers coming out our ears. And our senior cryptologist writes simple equidistant letter sequence codes on a 386. What am I missing here?
Probably the significance of what this means if it's true.
Oh, yeah, that all the secrets of the world are encoded in the Torah, and only God could have put them there. Is it?
Is it what?
Is it true?
Hang around a few minutes and I might be able to give you an answer.
What was the significance of these Bible codes? Could there be information encrypted in the book of Genesis having to do with people and places that could not have been known at the time the book was written? If the codes were simply a matter of random chance, the Gans program would soon reveal it. He was sure his wife would soon be calling to tell him his computer had stopped and the p-value, a numeric representation of probability, was a very large number. And that would be the end of it.
Mrs. Gans. Oh, hi. Did the machine stop running yet? What was that number again?
Well,
as a matter of fact, it is true. I don't think I've ever seen a p-value this small before. The probability that these codes could appear by accident it's virtually non-existent.
What Gans discovered that day was that everything was there, just as the study said it was, firmly fixed in the code. He also knew the controversy was just beginning.
I believe the Bible code issue is nonsense from beginning to end.
The overwhelming majority of scientists who have studied the phenomenon have come to the conclusion that there's no basis for it whatever.
We've come a long way since 1450 and Gutenberg's first movable type printing press. Today, this small disc contains the entire Bible. Any passage can be accessed at the push of a button. In just a matter of minutes, everything in the Bible relating to a particular subject can be accessed, collated, and printed out. But you know, for all of our sophistication and technological skill, we haven't been able to improve on the words. What they say and what they represent remains exactly the same. There is something that has recently captivated biblical scholars and scientists alike, however. It is the notion that there might be something more here than just the words that are on the surface. There is evidence that embedded within the Hebrew letters of what the Jews refer to as the Torah, that is Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, or the first five books of the Bible, there is a code that tells of events far into the future. A code that, according to some, could only have been put there by the original author, God himself. Some researchers have even suggested that Yeshua, the Hebrew name for Jesus Christ, has been found to be part of these codes throughout the Old Testament. As you might suspect, this idea has generated a great deal of controversy. But then, the Bible's been a source of debate ever since Moses brought down the Ten Commandments from Mount Sinai. There have always been those who love it and those who hate it.
All the good from the Savior of the world is communicated through this book. All things desirable to men are contained in the Bible.
If we would destroy the Christian religion, we must first of all destroy man's belief in the Bible.
The Bible is the greatest benefit which the human race has ever experienced.
The inspiration of the Bible depends upon the ignorance of the gentleman who reads it.
It is impossible to mentally or socially enslave a Bible-reading people.
One does well to put on gloves when reading the New Testament. Everything in it is cowardice and self-deception.
A thorough knowledge of the Bible is worth more than a college education.
The debate continues to this very day. But all other arguments aside, one fact is indisputable. Since Gutenberg printed the first Bible, it has become the most widely distributed and widely read book in the world. Every year, more copies of the Bible are printed than any other book ever published. A recent count put the number of complete Bibles printed in a single year at over 60 million. Another 90 million New Testaments were also printed, and over 1.5 billion scripture sections were published in over 2,000 languages. Amazingly, those numbers keep growing every year.
What is there in this book that has captivated the minds and hearts of people the world over for thousands of years? What could there possibly be in the history of a small group of people in a dusty corner of the world that could attract such attention? What is there in the words of these scrolls that has bound a scattered nation together for over 3,000 years?
The Old Testament, specifically the Torah, or the first five books of the Bible, is, according to its adherents, a history of God's dealings with mankind, and specifically the children of Israel. Yet it is filled with fantastic stories that many scholars insist cannot be true.
Was there a series of devastating plagues that overcame the great Egyptian pharaoh? Did a man called Moses actually receive the Ten Commandments and the Mosaic Law directly from God? Could this same Moses have miraculously opened a pathway through the Red Sea? The critics are relentless. Some even say the Exodus from Egypt never took place and Moses never existed. The words of the Torah, they insist, were penned by ancient Jewish leaders as a mechanism to control their people. Nothing more.
In a moment, we'll look at these issues through a modern lens and see if recent discoveries in modern technology can provide some answers to these age-old questions.
But assuming for the moment that Moses did exist, what are we to make of these new scientific studies that suggest there is more, much more? Today, the question being asked in ever-widening circles is simply, is there information about modern people, places, and events embedded in the ancient biblical text? Is there, in fact, a Bible code? Does this code contain information about Hitler and the Holocaust? about the reestablishment of Israel, the Six Days War? Did it actually anticipate the assassination of Yitzhak Rabin? And can it tell us what happiness or horror the future holds?
I was in Israel to meet with the chief of Israeli intelligence on a totally different subject 6 years ago, and I heard by chance about the work that a very famous mathematician in Jerusalem had done. He had found the exact day that the Gulf War would begin in a code in the Bible. And I thought this was just nonsense. I thought it was absurd. I said, I'm not religious, and began to walk away. Then I checked out this mathematician. Eliyahu Rips is no ordinary person. He's the world's leading expert in group theory, the field of math that underlies quantum physics. He's considered one of the greatest mathematicians in the world. So I went to see him. But in my mind, I was certain that, oh, in an hour tops, I would find out why he was wrong. Because this could not be true. There could not be a code in the Bible. No one can know the future. Instead of spending an hour with Dr. Rips, I spent a week with him. And at the end of the week, I knew he was on to something real.
Israeli officials will neither confirm nor deny that information regarding the first Scud attack was derived from researchers involved with the Bible code. But given the results, it is fair to ask if perhaps science and religion have not, at long last, found a common ground.
3 weeks before the Gulf War began, Dr. Rips and his colleagues in Israel found encoded in the Bible, Saddam Hussein picked a day, enemy, Scuds, and the date, January 18th, 1991, actually the equivalent in the ancient Hebrew calendar.
Perhaps before going on, we should try and answer some of the questions posed by the critics. Beginning with the most fundamental question of all, was there really a man named Moses? According to the book of Exodus, at the time Moses was born, the Pharaoh of Egypt had decreed that all male Hebrew children be killed. The mother of Moses, unwilling to follow this horrible edict, put her young son in a basket made of reeds and set it adrift on the river. The daughter of Pharaoh found the basket and took the child for her own son. Moses was transformed from the child of Hebrew slaves to the grandson of the Pharaoh in a single day. But Moses' life in the court of the Pharaoh came to an abrupt end when he saw an Egyptian taskmaster beating a Hebrew slave, and in a rage, Moses attacked the Egyptian and killed him. From that moment on, Moses became a fugitive from the wrath of Pharaoh, which brings us to the beginning of the most controversial series of events in the Bible. Moses fled into the desert to escape the Pharaoh's soldiers. After wandering for many days, he came across a small tribe of nomadic shepherds in what was then the land of Midian. He is befriended by Jethro, the head of one of the families, and there he determines to stay. In one stroke, Moses is transformed from Prince of Egypt to wandering shepherd. And so far as Moses is concerned, that will be his lot in life. But it was not to be. One day, while in the desert, he was startled by the sight of a burning bush that, while fully involved in flame, was not consumed. The Lord spoke to him out of the bush and told him he must return to Egypt. Critics are quick to point to this episode as proof the Bible is pure fantasy. Even apart from the burning bush, how could a middle-aged shepherd, who by his own admission was not a good speaker, be expected to go into Egypt, where he was still under sentence of death, and simply tell the Pharaoh he has to give up hundreds of thousands of slaves? The answer, according to the Bible, is a series of plagues that God permits Moses to call down upon the Egyptians. There are plagues of frogs and flies, of the water in wells, rivers, fountains, even urns turning to blood, of boils, dying cattle, and fiery hail. Finally, Moses names the most devastating plague. The firstborn of every Egyptian household will die. And therein lies the problem. Critics insist that the Egyptians were such astute record keepers that something so tragic, so all-encompassing, would certainly have been recorded by their own scribes, as well as by Moses. As it turns out, Recent discoveries have proven them right.
And there's an ancient Egyptian papyrus document called the Ipuwer Papyrus, and it recounts in eyewitness fashion the plague of blood, the plague of cattle disease, the plague of strange fire phenomena, the plague on the firstborn, the strange darkness, all the events that we previously thought we only knew about from the Bible. We can read about it in Egyptian records.
Given the severity of these plagues, it is not unlikely that the Pharaoh would at last let the people of Israel go. But somewhere along the line, he had a change of heart. And here the biblical record stands alone in its depiction of what many still regard as an unbelievable miracle. Yet except for this miracle, there would be no Bible or the possibility of a Bible code. Pharaoh's army of chariots was rapidly gaining on the slow-moving mass of humanity trying to make its way across the wilderness of Sinai. Suddenly, they found themselves facing the Red Sea with the Pharaoh's army closing in from behind. Moses, according to the Bible, raised his arms, and the Lord caused the sea to go back by a strong east wind that provided the children of Israel with an escape route. We can only imagine what a great act of faith it was for the children of Israel to follow the bidding of Moses and rush out into what just moments before had been an impassable sea. The way was open before them, but it was only a narrow strip of land with a wall of water on both sides. Behind them, the Pharaoh's army, bent on destruction, pressed forward. Terrified, but facing certain death, they rushed out onto the narrow bridge of land. It is not hard to imagine the Pharaoh's army coming to a standstill, staring in disbelief at the fleeing Israelites and giving them precious time to complete the crossing. According to tradition, Moses was the last to cross, and by the time he reached the other side, the Pharaoh's chariots and soldiers had recovered from their own fear and surprise and were already pouring out across the land bridge in angry pursuit. Theirs, however, was to be a different fate. The wind ceased and the water rushed in upon the Egyptian army, drowning men and horses alike. But could such a thing really have happened? Oddly enough, it was Napoleon who first discovered that indeed it could.
At this site in 1799, Napoleon's engineers discovered an underwater ridge some 600 feet wide that extended from shore to shore. His engineers calculated the right time for crossing this 5.2 mile strip when the east wind would blow sufficiently to clear the seabed of water. Napoleon, however, barely escaped with his life when a sudden change in the wind's direction brought an onrush of water covering the strip within just a matter of minutes.
Of course, those were 18th century engineers, and their records did little to satisfy the critics. 20th century scientists, however, have taken up the challenge with surprising results. Dr. Doran Knopf, professor of oceanography at the University of Florida, has developed an experiment to test the viability of the biblical account of Moses and the children of Israel crossing the Red Sea.
We were intrigued by the possibility that perhaps there is some explanation for a similar process. So what we did, we developed what we call in physical oceanography a mathematical model of the part of the Red Sea where many people believe that crossing could have been. Okay, what we have here now is a physical model of the Red Sea. The deep part supposed to represent the main body of the Red Sea, which is about 2,000 or 3,000 feet deep. And the shallow part, with the one with the sloping bottom, supposed to represent the Gulf of Suez, which is much shallower. As we said before, the average depth of the Gulf of Suez is about 100 feet, and the length is few hundred miles. Okay, what we have in addition to this, we have here, we introduced here an artificial ridge which you see right here, and the depth of the water above that artificial ridge is only about 10 feet high, okay? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to let the wind blow from here, and you will see how the water recedes and, in fact, exposes the ridge to the air. Okay, so what you can see now is that most of the water, in fact, to the left of the ridge is blown away. There is still some water there, and you see that there is an exposed area right there. All right? So the idea is that the Israelis crossed on this part of the ridge which was exposed, and they saw water on the two sides, right? They saw the water on the left side of the ridge and the water on the right side. And I'm going to cut the wind off now, and I'm going to do that abruptly, and you will see how it comes back. So let's do that. And of course, what happens after that is that when the wind relaxes, the water wants to come back to the position that it had before, and it does that via a gravity wave, which moves at the speed we calculated to be like 15 feet per second or so, which is, of course, a speed that one cannot escape.
Dr. Knopf's experiment demonstrates that the strong east wind could indeed have opened a passage through the Red Sea sufficient for the children of Israel to cross. And as Napoleon demonstrated, once the wind stopped, there could be no escape for the Pharaoh's army.
Modern research has shown that it was possible for the fleeing slaves to have crossed the Red Sea at this particular point. But how do we know this is where Moses brought his people? Once again, modern technology shows the way. Literally.
Infrared satellite imaging has tracked a large migration of people, their campsites, and their direction across the Sinai Peninsula with an astonishing correlation to the biblical account in Exodus.
With satellite infrared photography, there have been major archaeological discoveries found throughout the world. There's a trail that comes down the west branch of the Red Sea. The left-hand branch of it comes down to the tip of the Sinai Peninsula, stops there. It appears to come out the other side and then wanders north to the highest mountain in the area, Jabal al-Lawz. And we did find what I think is important archaeological evidence that something took place at Jabal al-Lawz. We found at the base of this mountain 12 pillars 18 and a half feet in diameter. Why not 7? Why not 11? Why 12? With 12 tribes of Moses fitting so perfectly into that scenario. Additionally, on the flat in front of this mountain, we found a large pile of rocks about 20, 24 feet tall. There's a petroglyph of an Egyptian, not an Arabic drawing, but an Egyptian drawing of the golden calf. And additionally, at the base of the mountain, we found kind of a wing-shaped foundation pointing towards the mountain. And there we found marble, round marble stones. This is some of the stone of it. This rock is not indigenous to that area of Saudi Arabia, let alone to Saudi Arabia. Somebody brought this in a tremendous distance. Something really did take place at this mountain, and it may well have been the Exodus.
All these findings seem to confirm the discovery of the real Mount Sinai according to information provided in the Bible. Could this then be the actual route of the Exodus? Are we now within sight of the biblical Mount Sinai and the miraculous meeting that produced the Torah?
Modern technology, it seems, can confirm that there was a man called Moses, that there was a massive exodus of people out of Egypt, and that these people did cross the Red Sea and go into the ancient land of Midian, now Saudi Arabia. But was Moses responsible for this book, the Torah, or what we commonly refer to today as the first five books of the Bible? And can modern technology confirm what may be the most fantastic biblical discovery of all time, the existence of the Bible code?
To find the answer to that question, we must first try and determine how the Torah was actually written. This is important because if the code exists, the plain text would have to be the same today as it was when Moses brought it down from the mountain. After nearly 4,000 years of copying and translation, is that even remotely possible? Dr. Eliyahu Rips decided to find an answer to that question, and in 1982 began an intensive study designed to prove or disprove, once and for all, the ancient Jewish tradition that holds there are hidden messages encrypted in the Torah.
it was 12 years before the completed study was published and came to the attention of Harold Gans. Since that study, the mystery of the Bible codes has sparked worldwide interest in the ancient text and sparked intense debate among scientists and biblical scholars alike. But is the idea of some sort of code in the Bible really new? What, if anything, does the Bible itself have to say about hidden or sealed information within its pages? Haven't there been others over the centuries who have tried to uncover hidden secrets in the pages of the Bible? What, if anything, did they discover? In the next few minutes, we'll try to provide answers to those questions and to what is perhaps the most intriguing question of all. After centuries of being on opposite sides, will science and religion finally come together in a single expression of truth? There are those who suggest they already have. When you stop to think about it, the Bible is truly an amazing book. It took 1,500 years to complete, 40 different writers contributed to its content in three languages, and as we know it today, it contains 66 books in two testaments, the Old and the New. The question that comes immediately to mind is, how could something so long in the making, so complex, and with so many different authors, possibly contain a code of any kind?
There's an ancient tradition among Jews concerning the Torah. This tradition claims that, unlike all other books of Scripture, the Torah alone was not merely inspired, it was dictated directly by God to Moses in a precise letter-by-letter sequence without punctuation or spaces between words.
Jews and Christians alike have long considered the words of the Bible to be divinely inspired. But this tradition suggests something different, something far more astounding. It suggests that God literally wrote the Torah. And if that's true, then we have to ask, is there any evidence that this tradition has some basis in fact?
Well, we need to understand that in the ancient texts, there were no spaces between the words. Scholars call this form of writing scripta continua. In other words, it was just a stream of letters. You inferred where the spaces between the words occurred. Archaeologists have discovered 22-line inscription this way. This is a pretty well-established fact in archaeology. The spaces between the words as we're used to it apparently were introduced during the days of Ezra, much, much later, of course, than the days of Moses.
The tradition, it seems, does have some archaeological support. That means that in the 40 days and 40 nights Moses was on Mount Sinai, he was busy writing down, in precise sequence, the entire 304,805 letters of the Torah. The question that jumps out at us is why? What could be the reason for requiring such a strict and difficult construction?
It is also part of the tradition that within the precise sequence of letters, there is encrypted information of a sort that only a divine hand could have placed there. However quaint and absurd that might seem, the tradition has a long and highly respected history. Nachmanides, one of the great Jewish sages, teaching in the 12th century, told his students that all of Israel's history could be found in Deuteronomy 32, commonly known as the Song of Moses. Another outstanding rabbi and teacher, who lived and died in the 13th century, Rabbi Bachya ben Asher of Saragossa, Spain, described a process whereby the skipping of equal intervals of letters in the Torah could lead to obtaining divinely ordained information. And in the 18th century, one of the greatest of the post-biblical sages, Elijah Solomon, known reverently as the Great One of Vilna, made the startling claim that all that was, is, and will be unto the end of time is included in the Torah. While these are only opinions, they are without question the opinions of some of the greatest Torah scholars of all time. Their influence on Jewish tradition cannot be overestimated.
It seems pretty clear that the idea of some kind of coded information in the Bible, specifically the Torah, has been with us for centuries. Would it surprise you to learn that the concept was not only believed, but actually enlarged upon by one of history's most famous scientists?
Sir Isaac Newton served as provost of Cambridge University for many years and is generally regarded as the first modern scientist. It is Newton who figured out the mechanics of the solar system and is credited with the discovery of the functions of gravity. He was also a firm believer in a biblical code.
Sir Isaac Newton, who was better at it than anyone, said that the entire universe, not just the Bible, the entire universe was a cryptogram, a code, set by the Almighty. And it was up to us to unravel this puzzle. And he, of course, also looked for a code that he was sure existed in the Bible that would reveal the future of mankind.
Newton left many of his personal papers at Cambridge when he retired. His biographer, John Maynard Keynes, discovered the papers and was shocked to learn that most of the million or more words in Newton's own handwriting had nothing to do with mathematics or astronomy, but rather esoteric theology. Newton was a firm believer in a Bible code. He was so certain there was a hidden code in the Bible that he spent over half his life trying to decipher it. The secret of the Bible code, if indeed it existed at all, would remain hidden for another 300 years. Ironically, it would be the greatest tragedy in Jewish history that would set the stage for the scientific discovery of coded information in the Bible. World War I had proven that being able to break enemy codes was absolutely vital to winning a war. By the time the Second World War broke out, cryptanalysis, the art of making and breaking codes, was well on its way to becoming a science. A small group of Polish mathematicians had broken the supposedly unbreakable German Enigma code in 1934. When America entered the war, the fledgling U.S. Signal Corps, later the National Security Agency, was able to keep one step ahead of the constantly mutating code, giving Allied generals and admirals advanced knowledge of German strategy. But in order to keep up with the ever-changing code, they had been forced to devise a means of making the large numbers of calculations required. What they came up with was a huge mechanical calculator they called a computation machine. These computation machines made cryptanalysis a viable science. As it turned out, they also gave the United States a huge advantage in harnessing the energy that would change the world.
During World War II, we of course were on a crash program to develop the atomic bomb, which required substantial computation. Dr. John von Neumann at Los Alamos and Dr. Alan Turing, both world-class scientists, collaborated to give us what we know today as the modern computer, both for the atomic bomb and also to unravel the Enigma codes of the Germans.
The invention of the atomic bomb undoubtedly changed the course of world history, but the invention of the computer itself has probably brought about even greater changes.
Rabbi Michael Ber Weissmandl, a childhood Talmudic and mathematical prodigy in Czechoslovakia prior to World War II, survived the Holocaust and after the war emigrated to the United States. Weissmandl, while still a young man, had stumbled onto the notes of the 13th century Rabbi Bakya, suggesting that divine information could be derived from the Torah by means of skipping a specific interval of letters. Now, with all the horror behind him, Weissmandl returned to the fascination of his youth, the possibility of a mysterious Bible code.
Rabbi Weissmandl, through his diligence and determination in his studies of the Torah, made some remarkable discoveries. The word Torah in Hebrew consists of four letters, a tau, a vav, a resh, and a he, which are equivalent for us to talk about as if it was a T, an O, an R, and an H. We should note here that the Hebrew alphabet consists of 22 letters that are essentially consonants. Vowels are generally simply inferred. The vav operates sort of what we would consider as an O, but it's not considered a vowel. In the book of Genesis, if you go to the first equivalent of a T and count 49 letters and then take the next one, in other words, the 50th letter, is the equivalent of what we would consider a vav. It's what we would consider an O. You count another 50 letters, it's a resh, or like our R. You count another 50 letters, and you come to a he, or like an H. In other words, it's as if you found a T-O-R-H at 49-letter intervals. It spells the word Torah. Rather remarkable in its own right, but one of those things you could dismiss as just a happenstance. But when you get to Exodus, you discover the same thing happens. You come to a T, 49 letters plus one, you get to the O, the R, and the H, the same way. And so again, this starts to look very designed. In fact, it's rather interesting that this number 50 are the number of days from the Exodus to the giving of the Torah at Mount Sinai. In pursuing this further, you go to the book of Leviticus, the third book, and this, nothing like this happens. But you go to the fourth book of the Torah, the book of Numbers, the same thing happens, but only if you spell Torah backwards. Kind of weird. You go to the book of Deuteronomy, again you find the equivalent thing, but only if you spell it backwards. Now, you wonder, what does this mean? And you stand back from it all. It's as if those four books are pointing to the middle book, two forward, two back, to the book of Leviticus. So you examine Leviticus more carefully and discover not 49 letter intervals, but 7 letter intervals.
Every eighth letter,
you have the word Yahweh, or the name of God. And you stand back from this whole thing and you realize the Torah is always pointing to the name of God. Rabbi Weissmandel's discovery is the first modern hint of hidden codes in the Bible, and of course has led to using computer to find others. Professor Daniel Michelson at UCLA has estimated that the probability of Weissmandel's discovery happening by accident is less than 1 in 3 million.
This discovery also has great significance to the ancient menorah lampstand, still used in Jewish practices today.
Like the lamps in Israel's ancient lampstand, the Hebrew word for law was encoded at 50-letter intervals in the opening paragraphs of Genesis and Exodus. The Eastern lamps point toward the servant lamp, the lamp of God, which was elevated above the others. Leviticus reveals that servant lamp design with Yahweh, the Hebrew word for Jehovah, encoded at 8-letter intervals in its opening verse. In the ancient menorah, the western lamps were reversed to point toward the servant lamp. Following that design, the word Torah was found to be encoded backwards in the introductory paragraphs of Numbers and Deuteronomy. Just as the lamps on either side of Israel's ancient menorah were ignited from the flame of the elevated lamp of God, these four encoded Torahs point to the glory of Yahweh, or Jehovah, in Leviticus.
It was the 50-year-old discovery of Rabbi Weissmandel that finally convinced a small group of Israeli scientists that computers might be the key that would unlock the centuries-old mystery of the Bible code.
It was Dr. Eliyahu Rips, one of the world's leading mathematical experts, who devised the first mathematical model to test the viability of the skip codes Weissmandel had apparently demonstrated. But he soon enlisted the help of Doran Whitson, a graduate student in physics specializing in general relativity, and Yoav Rosenberg, a brilliant young computer scientist. Together, they hoped to prove scientifically whether or not a Bible code existed. It would be a long and tedious undertaking.
Dr. Rips, in creating the Bible Code computer program, took the original Hebrew text of the first five books of the Bible, the words that, according to the Bible itself, God dictated to Moses on Mount Sinai 3,200 years ago. And all he did to that text was to eliminate the breaks between the words, so that instead of words on a page, it became one long strand of letters, 304,805 Hebrew characters, from the first letter in Genesis to the last letter in Deuteronomy, with no break in words. So perhaps Dr. Rips was restoring the Bible, the Torah, the first five books of the Bible, to its original form. In any event, he was not changing the order of the letters. He was just eliminating the breaks between the words. He then programmed a computer to look for really a very simple code that would reveal new information. Skip any equal number of letters, and the new information was revealed.
Perhaps we should take a moment here and explain exactly what an equidistant letter sequence, or ELS code, is and how it's constructed. To detect an ELS code, a computer must first be programmed to write down the first letter of the encoded word, represented in our formula by N. The computer will then skip a fixed number of letters, represented here by the character D. Write that letter skip the same number of letters, and write that letter, and so on. Let's try a simple example. Rips explained that each code is a case of adding every fourth or 12th or 50th letter to form a word. Skip X spaces and another X spaces, and the hidden message is spelled out. This appears to be nothing more than a simple description of ELS coding, but if you begin with the first letter of the paragraph, R, then skip every three letters and pick up the fourth letter following, the coded message is revealed. What is infinitely more difficult is the creation of a surface text that is sensible and easily understood and yet will seamlessly accommodate specific letters at fixed intervals. That process is called encryption.
There are several things that have to be understood about the entire equidistant letter sequence coding. Just looking for words, virtually any words, as an equidistant letter sequence, you will find them in the Book of Genesis, you will find them in War and Peace, you will find them in virtually any sufficiently long text that you try to find them in, particularly if you're using a computer. In any case, what is found is generally random. You have to apply statistical analysis to determine whether or not what you found is in fact random, or is in fact well beyond what you'd expect to find at random.
The key to statistical significance is how many related terms are found in a small area of biblical text and how many characters are in each term. Short words in lots of text are very likely just coincidence. So, if all text can produce words at equidistant letter sequences, what makes the Torah codes unique?
Now, it's amazing. And only in the Bible do you find this. When, for instance, by skipping an equal number of letters, you spell out President Kennedy, the very next letters in the same skip sequence say to die, and Dallas is encoded in the same place. When you look for Shakespeare, the very next words in the same equal distance skip sequence say we'll present plays on stage, and Hamlet and Macbeth are encoded in the same place. You could find Kennedy or Shakespeare in some equal distance skip in any big enough text. If not in War and Peace, look in a bigger book. Eventually you will find some equal distance skip sequence that does spell out the name of any historical figure. But only in the Bible will you find encoded consistently in the same place accurate related information.
In order to test the ELS code theory, the research team created a program according to strict scientific and statistical rules. The usable text would be only the Book of Genesis, some 78,000 letters. In order to make certain the results could not be tainted by subjective interpretation, they selected the names of 34 of Israel's most famous and revered sages as the target of their search. To make it more difficult, they also asked the program to search for either the target's birth date or death date. After months of work, the incredibly complex mathematical model and program was ready. Now it was up to the computer. The results of this test startled even the researchers. All 34 names were there, coded into the text, along with either their date of birth or date of death.
He used statistics correctly, and he found that the information encoded in the Bible was encoded there against odds of 10 million to 1. He looked for the same information in War and Peace and two original Hebrew texts, and there found nothing but random letter combinations. Only in the Bible did he find consistent, coherent information against odds of 10 million to 1.
Science, it seems, has the key to unlocking the secrets of the Bible codes. Still, there are those who are critical of the discovery. In part two of Secrets of the Bible Code Revealed, the critics will have their say. Also, you'll find out precisely what the Bible codes have revealed about our day, and if there are codes other than ELS codes in the Bible. Don't miss Secrets of the Bible Code Revealed, part two. In Secrets of the Bible Code Revealed, Part 1, we met three world-renowned scientists, Dr. Eliyahu Rips,
Doran Whitsum, and Yoav Rosenberg. These men, working as a team over a period of 4 years, devised a scientific model for determining whether or not equidistance letter sequence codes were encrypted into the text of the Torah or the Old Testament. The results electrified the religious world and shocked the scientific community. It appeared the codes were real, but could the code researchers defend their findings before their scientific peers?
The first experiment was a comprehensive experiment, encompassing a large body of words and expressions that have a connection, like names and nicknames of the great sages and rabbis of Israel, as listed in the encyclopedia along with their dates of birth and dates of death. We measured if indeed there was a tendency for such connections, and the result was that there were connections, and the possibility that this occurred by accident was very minimal.
Harold Gans, at the time a senior cryptologist at the National Security Agency in Maryland, heard of the test and the results.
I reproduced the experiment, and lo and behold, I got precisely the results that they had reported. I then went ahead and did a new experiment. Instead of pairing each of the rabbis' names and appellations with their dates of birth and death, I paired them with the places of birth and death, cities, towns, villages, wherever it was they died or were born. And the results I got were even more significant than the original experiment done by Whitsum and Rips. At that point, I knew beyond any shadow of a doubt that the code was real. I felt a chill go up my spine.
Encouraged by the results, the study was sent to the prestigious American mathematics journal Statistical Science for peer review and possible publication. Indeed, nothing is published in statistical science until it's been thoroughly reviewed by at least one independent referee, and on occasion, two. In this instance, the documentation was submitted to three separate referees. Following its publication, a statement was issued by five mathematical scholars, two from Harvard University, one from Yale University, and two from Hebrew University, supporting the findings. Robert Koss, the editor of Statistical Science Journal and a professor at Carnegie Mellon University, is quoted as saying, "Our referees were baffled. Their prior beliefs made them think that the book of Genesis could not possibly contain meaningful references to modern-day individuals. Yet when the authors carried out additional checks, the effect persisted. The paper is thus offered to statistical science readers as a challenging puzzle."
All my instincts as a scientist and also as a Jew spoke against the possibility of such a phenomenon. Yet despite this, the work of Whitsum, Rips, and Rosenberg presents a very strong scientific evidence that under intense scientific experimentation, the phenomenon is shown to exist.
I went to meet with mathematicians at Harvard, at Yale, at Hebrew University. And they knew Dr. Rips and they knew about his work, and they all told me the code was real. I asked Dr. Rips to look for things that he didn't know I would ask for until I asked. And then he found them in the Bible code, and he had as a control text the Hebrew translation of War and Peace. In the Bible, the information was encoded, and in War and Peace it was not, time after time after time.
Yet in spite of the overwhelming support for the scientific integrity of the initial code research, there are still those scientists who insist it is all just numerological rubbish.
You can compare the reaction of this handful of noisy critics toward Dr. Rips' extraordinary discovery to the reaction of both the church and the scientific community to Galileo. When Galileo said that the earth circled the sun, he was condemned by the scientific establishment and by the religious establishment. Because what he had discovered changed the way you must see the world forever.
The criticisms all have to do with the fact that in science, one does not proceed explaining an effect by invoking a miraculous cause.
A major premise of the Bible codes is that the text has remained totally unchanged through the centuries, all the way back to the time of Moses. But in fact, this simply is not the case. The manuscripts from the earlier periods are not the same as manuscripts from the later periods. This totally invalidates the notion of a Bible code based on counting letters. What manuscript do you use? What variants do you use? It's totally ridiculous.
The point is well taken, but once again, the experts disagree.
Bible scholars have long been aware that over the millennia, the Torah has been preserved with an amazingly small number of letter-level variations. Even to this very day, a Torah scroll is copied by hand from its predecessor, written out according to unchanging rules by scribes who undergo an exacting course of training and preparation. To each of them, the following warning has been passed down through the ages. Should you perchance omit or add one single letter from the Torah, you would thereby destroy all the universe.
The text of the Torah has been preserved not only in pages, lines, and words, but even in the exact spelling of every word. In the Ashkenazic text, I found 9 words, the spelling of which is not exact to my opinion. But in the Yemenite text preserved the exact spelling of every word without even one exception.
It cannot be said, of course, that the text of the Torah used worldwide today in Jewish practice is the original text. No process carried out by humans can possibly be perfect, but the small number of errors that are known to have crept in over the centuries is striking. The question of the reliability of the text is, however, only one point of contention. In spite of the years of testing and peer review, many prominent mathematicians still believe any words or combinations of words found in the Bible code, no matter how closely aligned, are at best matters of random chance, and at worst, the result of text manipulation.
The computer can look in so many different ways at a text that finding hidden messages in it is almost guaranteed. For example, I looked at the United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea, and I found in there the hidden message, "Hear all the law of the sea." I looked at the text of Moby Dick, and I found the hidden message, "Oceans hold joy." Both of these are extremely unlikely to occur by chance, yet they did occur.
People have claimed that they found similar codes in Moby Dick, in War and Peace, that they could find similar codes in any text of one's choice. That is absolute nonsense. They have indeed produced counterfeit codes in War and Peace and in Moby Dick, and they can produce them in virtually any text. They are not the same as the real thing. They are not done a priori. They are done by cheating. Their claim is that since we can cheat on the data and bias the experiment to do whatever we want, therefore Whitstam and Ripps could have done the same, and therefore we shall assume that they have done the same. They do not deal at all with the fact that my city's experiment proves that that is not the case. And by the way, to accept their challenge, I would say, I would like to see them try to produce an experiment like my city's experiment to confirm their rabbi's experiment that succeeded so well in War and Peace. They haven't done so. They haven't even addressed the city's experiment because it proves that, in fact, there was no such manipulation. What they have done is very similar to what Whitstam and Ripps have done. To the layperson, to the expert, they have nothing in common.
I studied the work of Dr. Ripps and his partners, and the outcomes of his experiment expresses his own wishes and desires rather than any real scientific phenomenon.
The quality of a cluster of words you find is really a sign of the cleverness of the person doing the looking and not of any intrinsic character of the document you're looking at.
Behind every picture is a statistical analysis that's performed by the computer program Ripps and his colleagues have created. It's not just a picture. It's not words that appear together by chance in the Bible. It is accurate, related details of major world events that appear together way beyond mathematical chance. The fake codes that the critics find in Moby Dick or War and Peace or the Manhattan Telephone Directory have no underlying mathematical basis at all. They are just pictures that to laymen might look similar, but are absolutely irrelevant.
Amongst the independent experiments that we've done, we matched the names of the famous rabbis against the names of the books they wrote. We also did an experiment where we matched their names against the years of their birth and death, remembering that the original experiment only used the day and the month. In both cases, we found absolutely no sign of any phenomenon.
There are some cases where critics have done experiments that appear to be designed to fail. They use data which is extremely questionable, data that was left out because of the fact that it was questionable, and they've done an experiment using only the questionable data. Perhaps they simply haven't thought it through thoroughly, or perhaps they specifically designed it to fail. But when one does many experiments of that sort, of an inferior quality, and then claims that he hasn't had a success, I say, why should we be surprised?
The strength of the famous rabbi's experiment is that it seemed to not require an act of faith on the part of the readers, but rather to be a standard, objective, repeatable scientific experiment. Close examination of this evidence shows it to be completely subjective and arbitrary, completely reliant on faith in the honesty of the people who did it, and that disqualifies it as being scientific evidence.
Professor Rips is an honest man. Everybody who meets him, who has talked with him, spent time with him, he comes across as an honest man. It's very hard to conceive that he was part of a process that rigged anything up. And so you have a case where he's basically being accused of a fraudulent, consciously fraudulent experiment. And it's a serious charge. It's the kind of thing that can ruin a professor to be involved in something that, I mean, professors have to have a point of view for the truth. So you have an inconsistency. You have an honest man, and you have an experiment, and you have a critic. And there's an inconsistency between the experiment, the honesty of the man, and what the critics say.
45 professional mathematicians with PhDs in universities have signed a petition saying that they don't believe in the codes. There's nothing wrong with that. They can express their opinion. These are mathematicians. These are people with PhDs. These are people who have written many papers that have gone through peer review. Why haven't they submitted their view to peer review? Why is it they're signing a petition? I ask you one question. When was the last time a scientific issue was decided by petition?
I also found the data to have too many degrees of freedom. It was already clear from looking at the clusters which they included that what makes this work is what I like to call wiggle room. It's the fact that one has choices, and because of the choices, you'll find something. You can keep looking until some choice works.
Let me show you one more experiment done by an independent researcher, Dr. Alex Rottenberg. And the beauty of this experiment is that there is absolutely no wiggle room. This code found in the book of Genesis that deals with the story of Esther allows no room for manipulation. We're taking names of people, the 10 sons of the arch-villain Haman. They all died on one day, the 13th of Adar. Again, names of people and date of death. 10 people, but the spellings are given to us in the book of Esther. No changes, no manipulation possible. We use the spellings exactly as they occur and check if they're next to the date of death. Yud Gimel Ba'adar. And lo and behold, one of these dates of death, incredibly, continues with the word Purim in code, the name of the holiday that is celebrated with the Book of Esther. Using this particular date, incredibly small probabilities were arrived at in terms of the proximity of the names of those 10 sons to this particular date of death. There is no room for manipulation. There's no place where we could have changed it in any way. The names are given to us in a thousands of year old document. I think that's the most impressive thing that we have.
Assuming for the moment the code is real, what is its significance? What does the existence of the code mean to the average Christian or Jew? Couldn't some diligent, hardworking scribes have put the code in place over the centuries?
The Torah has been in its present form, according to all authorities, for an absolute minimum of 2,000 years, when it was translated into the Greek under the reign of Ptolemy II in Alexandria, the Septuagint. We can demonstrate, using the laws of quantum mechanics, specifically the uncertainty principle, and chaos theory, that it is absolutely impossible within the laws of physics and mathematics as we know it today to know the future in detail as is demonstrated in these codes. Consequently, we come to the scientific conclusion that the author of these codes is not bound by the laws of physics and mathematics as we understand it.
It's obviously far beyond the ability of man to do. In fact, man didn't even discover the codes until the advent of the computer, so it was impossible for him to have put them there. The very fact that they're there is the signature of the Creator himself. That is his way of assuring us that he is precisely who he said he is. In that document that is the core of the Judeo-Christian tradition.
Many believe that with the discovery of the Bible codes, science has brought us closer to an understanding of the divinity of the origins of the Bible. But what does the Bible itself have to say about hidden messages?
Many people are surprised to discover that there are codes in the Bible, and these equidistant letter sequences are but one of them. Some are hidden, some are revealed, some are a key part of the narrative, like the handwriting on the wall in Daniel 5. The Bible points out that it is the glory of God to conceal a matter, and the glory of kings to search them out. The computer has simply made it possible for us to discover codes that would be very difficult to find any other way.
Originally, it was thought that only the Torah contained Bible codes. We now know that the entire Tanakh, commonly known as the Old Testament, has encoded information within the Hebrew text. Also, software is presently being developed to determine if there is a Bible code present in the Textus Receptus, the Greek New Testament used for the King James Bible translation.
Perhaps the age-old enemies, science and religion, can get together after all. But confirming the existence of the code was just the beginning of the adventure. It is the information contained in the code that has ignited the debate and focused the attention of the world on the Bible once again. In 1994, Michael Drosnin, a writer and former journalist with the Wall Street Journal and the Washington Post, flew to Israel to meet with a close friend of then Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin. He carried with him a letter with frightening implications.
Using the Bible code myself, about 2 years into my investigation, I found encoded the name of the Prime Minister of Israel, Yitzhak Rabin. The only time his name was encoded in the Bible, and crossing his name, as plain as day, were the words, "Assassin will assassinate." I was shocked. So I flew to Israel, and I met with Yitzhak Rabin's closest friend, a very well-known Israeli writer, Chaim Guri. And I told Rabin in that letter exactly what I've just told you, that the one time his name, Yitzhak Rabin, was encoded in the Bible, the words, "assassin will assassinate," ran right across his name.
Are you seriously suggesting the Torah actually says that Rabin will be assassinated?
All I can tell you is what's in there. Will you give him the letter?
In his letter, Michael Drosnin told the Prime Minister, "I have uncovered information that suggests your life is in danger." He went on to explain that it was an Israeli mathematician that had discovered a hidden code in the Bible that appears to reveal the details of events that took place thousands of years after the Bible was written. The letter also pointed out that the information had been confirmed by famous mathematicians, and the results have been replicated by a senior codebreaker at the Pentagon using his own computer program.
This should not be ignored.
Guri read the letter, but his response was not very encouraging.
All right, I'll take it to him. But I know the Prime Minister, and I don't believe he'll pay any attention to these Bible codes.
Guri's assessment proved all too accurate. The Prime Minister made no attempt to contact Drosnin and apparently ignored the warning completely.
And of course, a year later, he was killed, exactly as the Bible code said he would be, indeed in the very year that the Bible code said he would be killed, all found a year in advance. I failed, because I had tried to warn the Prime Minister. I had managed to put the warning in his hands. He'd ignored the warning, and now he was dead. I do not control what anyone does, let alone what a prime minister does. I'm used to reporting on events that already have taken place, not telling people what might happen tomorrow. It's a very strange position for me to be in as a reporter, but I cannot ignore this. I'm doing only what I've always done as a reporter. I'm checking out the information, and once I determine it's accurate, I'm sharing it with as many people as possible. But yeah, the responsibility does feel larger. There's no question of it.
In his book, The Bible Code, Michael Drosnin explains a series of events in some detail. However, Drosnin's discovery of the Rabin assassination in The Bible Code has triggered controversy on a whole new level. Can the code be used to let us see into the future? If not, what purpose does it serve?
The Bible codes are there so when the future happens, it confirms Scripture as the divinely inspired Word of God.
The Bible code reveals accurate details about people and events that took place, who lived long after the Bible was written. We can go to events as recent as the bombing in Oklahoma, where we have the name of the building that was blown up, the Marab building, encoded, Oklahoma encoded, even the name of the man who was arrested and convicted for the crime, Timothy McVeigh, all encoded in a document that's 3,000 years old. Watergate is encoded. The one time that word appears, there's a question. Who is he? President, but he was kicked out. Economic crisis is encoded one time in the Bible, and with it is the year of the great stock market crash, the year the Great Depression began, 1929. The collision of the comet with Jupiter in July 1994, found 2 months before the collision took place, was encoded twice in the Old Testament, with the exact name of the comet, Shoemaker-Levy, which had only been discovered a year earlier. In both cases, the name of the comet actually crossed the name of the planet, Jupiter, and in one of the encodings, we had the exact day of impact. Of course, World War II and the Holocaust are very clearly encoded in extraordinary detail. We have Hitler encoded with Nazi and enemy, an evil man and slaughter.
The whole world was saddened and astonished when Lady Di tragically was killed in an accident in Paris, France. Yet when we began to do research with the computer program, we were astonished to discover that even this event had been recorded in ELS codes 3,500 years before it occurred. We found the name Princess and Diana encoded at the same ELS distance. Then beside it, we found the word Spencer, her real name, together with Wales, as she was the Princess of Wales. Then in the surrounding verses, we found encoded France and Paris. Then we looked and discovered tunnel and river. We found the very year, 5757, which is 1997 in our calendar. We found Av, the month of August when she was killed. Most remarkably of all, we found the name Fayed, her companion, in that tragic accident. All of this encoded 35 centuries before the event actually occurred.
Logic tells me that the Bible was encoded to give us very important information. It was encoded, certainly, by some intelligence that could see ahead across time. It was encoded in such a way that it would be found right now by a technology that would exist for the first time now. The computer.
When going into the future, we have to guess at the words because the event hasn't happened yet. We don't know what it is. As soon as you start guessing the words, as soon as you start guessing the context and trying to determine what would be the event that would use these words, you're out of the realm of science. You're guessing. It's subjective. It's not scientific anymore.
The Bible code does not give us one predetermined future. It tells us all of our possible futures. And by having this information in advance, we can prevent the worst dangers from ever taking place.
The more important question might be, will we, in the final analysis, believe what we learn?
News from around the world.
Nations, as well as individuals, seem to have a knack for ignoring important warnings. World War II gives us some excellent examples. Prior to America's entrance into World War II, the Japanese adapted the German Enigma code into an advanced variation the Allies called Purple. A brilliant cryptographer by the name of William Friedman, head of the fledgling Signal Intelligence Agency, was determined to crack it. With unbelievable dedication, Friedman almost single-handedly cracked the code in just over 20 months. His effort had been so intense that upon completing the task, he suffered a complete mental collapse. But the impossible had been accomplished. The Germans were leaked the information that Purple had been cracked and sent the information on to the Japanese, who simply refused to believe it. Their plan to attack Pearl Harbor went forward, and in fact, naval intelligence intercepted and decoded a transmission from Japanese Admiral Yamamoto to his fleet. The Japanese refused to believe their code could be broken, but now it was America's turn. Naval intelligence had in their hands confirmation that the Japanese fleet was heading toward Pearl Harbor. The monumental effort Friedman had put forth was about to pay off. Or was it?
What is this?
It just came in, sir. Our boys back at Signal have broken Purple.
Sure they have. Have you told anyone about this?
No, sir.
Then don't. Those guys over at Signal haven't cracked that code. I think somebody's trying to see if we're awake over here.
But, sir...
That's all.
The Signal Intelligence Service had intercepted and decoded a message from Admiral Yamamoto to his fleet and immediately passed the information on to naval intelligence. But the warning was dismissed. Even the American officers didn't believe that the code had been broken.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy, the United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
There seems to be an eerie parallel between the attitude of the admirals then and the eagerness of some scientists and scholars to dismiss the Bible code today. Could ignoring this code also prove disastrous?
As far back as records exist, decryptions and hidden meanings seem to have derived from the obsession of the Jewish scribes with the ancient scriptures. And these techniques led to the encryption techniques of the Renaissance, which led to the cipher wheels and the mechanical aids in World War II, superseded, of course, by the modern computer. It's interesting that it's now the computer that allows us to discover these secret codes that apparently were hidden there from the beginning.
Was the assassination of Israeli Prime Minister Yitzhak Rabin predicted a full year before it actually happened? Does the book of Deuteronomy contain a series of encoded words that reveal the names of the major participants in today's Israeli peace process? Could we have known months in advance that the federal building in Oklahoma City would be bombed and the name of the man who would do it? Is there buried within the ancient text of the Torah information about the assassination of Robert Kennedy, predictions of man walking on the moon, and warnings of the sinking of the Titanic? Are we continuing to discover that God actually dictated warnings to Moses nearly 3,500 years ago that appear to be meant for us today?
While the critics of the Bible Code continue to attack the original Bible Code discoveries, numerous Bible Code software developers have commercially advanced Bible Code research way beyond the pioneer findings of the late 1980s. New ELS research is moving beyond the nominal word association pattern discoveries of the past to complex matrix discoveries. Here's the full Thomas Edison matrix revealing in an orderly model 55 important historical items about his life. In the Bible Code, we've discovered the USA Embassy terrorist bombings in the African nations of Kenya and Tanzania. For example, in the Kenya bombing, there were 19 reference terms with multiple mentions of specific facts that describe the terrorist attack, all located in a compact matrix centered in Haggai 1:14. Embassy was the central term of the matrix, with USA crossing over embassy three times. We found in the same tight matrix, the location being Nairobi, Kenya, August 7, 1998, the date of the bombing, in the morning at 10:45, that 247 people were killed and murdered by a truck bomb. We also found the names of the three alleged terrorists.
The most important warning in the Bible Code is that we might face the real Armageddon, a nuclear world war, perhaps in the near future.
Even as the controversy continues, we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that no matter which of the experts we choose to believe, in the final analysis, we must each decide how this new reality will impact our thoughts and actions. Science seems to have proven that the code is beyond the element of chance, and the scope of the encryption would appear to be beyond the scope of human ability, which brings us to the information in the code itself. Could it be divinely ordained, as Rabbi Bakia suggested?
The discovery of the Bible codes in our generation provides powerful evidence to skeptics that the Bible truly is the inspired Word of God. They also validate almost a decade of work by my friend, Yaakov Ramzel, a Messianic pastor in San Antonio, Texas, who manually has examined the Hebrew Scriptures and has found the very same phenomena in the Bible codes.
Yaakov Ramzel has unwittingly added a whole new layer of controversy to discussion of the Bible code. But in all fairness, it must be said he was working on the code long before the scientists.
Over 20 years ago, Ramzel began his search for the name of Yeshua, or Jesus, in the codes. He used the same skip sequence technique as Weissmandl had done many years earlier. And like Weissmandl, Ramzel didn't have a computer. What he did have was an enormous amount of dedication and a firm belief that the codes hinted at by the Jewish sages were real.
In Genesis 1, in the Torah, beginning in the fifth verse, the first word, counting every 172 letters, every 172 letters, spells the name Yeshua in Hebrew, which means Jesus. Then at the end of the Torah in Deuteronomy, starting at the very last portion, counting in reverse every 172 letters, spells HaMashiach, the Messiah. In Genesis 20 and verse 2, counting every five letters in there, HaKarech Ot Shlav in Hebrew, which means in English, the lattice work of the equidistance letter sequence. The meaning of the insight is the method by which we found it. Now, if this is not scientific, I don't believe there's anything scientific. This is the most remarkable insight proving that the letter sequence is ethical, it's mathematical, it's scientific, and it sets a pattern. And we have the Ten Commandments recorded in Exodus 20th chapter. There are 179 words in that chapter. In every 179th letter, we have a wonderful insight. If you count every 179th letter, it spells Hosea Yeshua Shmi, which means salvation of the Lord Jesus is my name.
Some critics, of course, have suggested Ramzel's work is a matter of pure chance, suggesting that even though the name Yeshua does appear, it doesn't necessarily refer to Jesus of Nazareth.
The prophet Isaiah wrote a powerful prophecy about the coming Messiah that is recorded in Isaiah chapter 52 and 53. This remarkable prophecy of the future Messiah is often called the suffering servant messianic prophecy. In an exhaustive analysis of this brief but very detailed prophecy, Yaakov Ramzel made several startling discoveries. Not only had God encoded the name of Jesus Christ in these passages, but the names of virtually everyone else involved in the crucifixion and his ministry. he found Jesus, the name the Nazarene, Messiah, three Marys, the two high priests, Ananias and Caiaphas, King Herod, Pilate, and many of the names of Christ's disciples, all of them found in one prophetic passage, 41 names in all encoded in Isaiah's prophecy.
One fact about the Bible that is not in dispute, and that is that both the Old Testament and the New are full of numbers. Some of these numbers are simple and straightforward. Others leave the reader completely befuddled. Could the key to the Bible encryptions lie in these enigmatic numbers?
It would be difficult to discover the number of times seven appears in some significant way in the Bible. Seven churches, seven lampstands, seven seals, seven trumpets, seven thunder, seven angels, seven miracles, seven beatitudes, and the 7 days of Genesis. And this barely begins to scratch the surface. Weissmandl discovered Yahweh at a skip interval of seven, and Torah at a skip interval of 49, or seven times seven. And in one of the Bible's most amazing prophecies, Daniel is told that 70 sevens are determined upon the people and upon the holy city. When Peter asks Christ how many times he should forgive a brother, the Savior answers with that same enigmatic number, 70 times 7. Is it possible that there is a key to the code hidden somewhere in the number or combination of numbers of 7? Or are these simply isolated events, independent of one another? Then again, perhaps the key is not numeric at all. The ELS code is, of course, based on numbers. But is there also evidence of other kinds of codes?
The most essential truths in the Bible are, of course, put in a form that anyone can understand. But that doesn't preclude the fact that there are mysteries hidden in the Bible that are there as challenges to us. And there are many examples. One of the classic ones is the life of Matthew Fontaine Maury, who as a youngster was fascinated as he read the scriptures that there was a passage in the Psalm 8 and also in Isaiah that makes reference to pathways in the seas. What a strange idea, he thought. Are there pathways in the sea? In 1825, he became a midshipman, spent the rest of his life gathering data, developing what we now know as the science of oceanography. He was able to get captains to gather data. He ended up developing charts of ocean currents in the Atlantic, the Pacific, and the Indian Oceans. And he, as a result, is widely regarded throughout the world as the father of the science of oceanography, all because he was prompted by these hidden little allusions in the Psalms and Isaiah. Two key points regarding the codes. First, we never look to codes or something that esoteric for doctrine or theology that's in any way contradictory to the plain text. The second point is we are expressly prohibited in the Torah from methods of divination. Using the codes to predict the future is divination and is expressly prohibited in the Bible.
Predicting the future or not being able to predict the future? Well, that's a controversy for another time after scientists and Bible scholars have had a chance to further study and debate this developing issue. There is a way you can check all this out for yourself. The Bible code is no longer just a name of a scientific research paper. It's also a computer program available on CD-ROM.
Bible code software is easy to use, even if the user has no knowledge of Hebrew. The procedure is very simple. First, select the range of text you wish to examine. For example, we will choose from the start of Genesis to the end of Exodus. Now select the range of skips you want the computer to use. We will use for this example a minimum of 10,000 and a maximum of 11,000. Now comes the most important part. Select the word or phrase you want the computer to find in the specified text. For our example, we will use the name Jesus. Click the First Names Dictionary and search for the name Jesus. Click on it and the program will automatically insert Yeshua, which is Hebrew for Jesus. Hit the Find Command button and the computer will immediately begin searching the specified text. A progress bar tracks the search, and a status box tells you how many times the computer has found the Hebrew name for Jesus. Once the name is found, the program shows it on a matrix. And then it will identify other Hebrew words, such as Nazarene, in the same matrix. Then automatically it will give the English translations.
Computer Bible code software research and development is moving at light-year speed, yet it will be years before the full extent of what the Bible code has to tell us is fully known. The new matrix decoding systems combined with translation software, lexicons, and dictionary searches open up the strong possibilities that people may be able to find themselves and or future events in the Bible code.
Certainly it seems harmless enough, but the original code researchers warn that even though the computer makes it easy, the process is complex and the results could easily be misinterpreted.
The worst thing that could happen is that some people might interpret what they find in the Bible code as commandments, telling them what to do. But nothing of that nature can or even should be inferred.
But in spite of the inherent complexities of knowing too little about too much and drawing unwarranted conclusions from them, code researchers and critics alike have found a great deal to ponder in the code research. For many, it has meant a re-examination of long-held but forgotten beliefs. For others, a strengthening of their faith. And for still others, it is just another shot fired in the long war between religionists and humanists. But since even much of the plain surface text of the Bible is still being debated, it should not surprise us that opening the time lock that has sealed the ELS codes for so many centuries has raised some controversy.
I believe God, in his prophetic foreknowledge, knew that our generation would be the most skeptical and the most scientific and computer literate generation in history. And therefore, I believe, knowing this, he has provided one last measure of evidence to our generation so that our generation would be without excuse.
I think if the Bible codes are demonstrated to be real and valid, then in fact both Jews and Christians will have to re-examine their texts and see truly how they impact on their lives.
What are the implications to the world if the Bible code is real? It's hard to say. People believe what they want to believe. People do really what they want to do. One would like to believe that if people took the Bible more seriously, there would be less crime, there would be less hurt, there would be less wars, everyone would love each other as a human being. I hope it would make a big difference.
I think the fact is the world will ignore much of the information. It's ignored important lessons in the past. However, the message will be, examine how you run your life.
I think the implications for Christianity of the Bible codes, to the extent they get increasingly validated and people begin to realize what they are staggering, because it's we're long overdue as Christians in taking the Bible seriously. The great tragedy is that most Christians have no comprehension of how reliable and how authoritative our Bible really is. And the Bible codes are exciting, if for no other reason, they cause people to realize that we have something in our hands that's more than simply a collection of colorful legends and moral principles. There's something far more profound in our hands.
For both Jews and Christians alike, it gives us solid scientific evidence that the Bible, which is the Bible for both of our religions, is not the product of a human hand. I think that's very important.
If the Bible codes are what they appear to be, evidence of authentication that this collection of 66 books, in fact, comes from an ultimate author, that implies that we have a destiny for which we are going to be accountable. And deep down inside, that's discomforting.
The Israeli mathematician who discovered the Bible code, Dr. Rips, thinks that we have found only the first and simplest level of a code that is probably far more complex and far beyond our reach. As a mathematician, his assumption is that if we find this clearer pattern, there is almost certainly a much larger pattern. But we don't yet have the mathematical tools or perhaps the technology to see it.
Rips has devised the measure which goes into two dimensions, whereas the original Torah truly is only one dimensional. It's a one-dimensional text, such as a sequence of letters going from beginning to end. Who knows but that a three-dimensional measure might not work even better, or four or five. Who knows how many dimensions there are to the Torah in terms of this code?
The discovery of the Bible codes is one of the most exciting events in history. For the first time, there is actually widely accepted scientific proof that the Bible is truly supernatural.
I knew I was on to something of real importance. It was the happiest time of my life.
You can't escape the fact that these things are beyond the realm of just accidental curiosities. They're there by design.
What we have exposed is that there is a hidden text in the Torah, and what we see is that in this text, the future, present, and past are all encoded, and thus it encompasses all things.
The good news is that some intelligence cared enough about us to leave us these warnings, to give us this information. That's very good news indeed. The question now is, what are we going to do with it? That's entirely up to us.
In a world that has grown skeptical, even hostile toward the Word of God, the Bible Code has built a bridge between science and religion and forced a re-examination of the ancient truths held sacred by millions of people. The Code also seems to be generating a new awareness of the divinity of the Scriptures among individuals of all faiths. This fact alone could make the Bible Code discovery the most important event of the modern era. Because if we really understand that the Bible is the Word of God, we are in possession of God's own saving truth.